Shout out to my ex. You really are a lovely guy.
Yeah. No, it's never going to work, is it?
No.
It's never going to work. That doesn't work with meme culture.
No.
You can't post one of those.
Did you watch any of the Brits?
I watched all of the Brits.
You are a mad person.
I watched it from start to finish. It's in our questions, so...
I like the...
that fault.
I like the David Gray tribute. They got the little kind of...
Well, that ginger
boss,
bloke.
Boss-eyed sort of midget to do the David Gray... What? What do you mean? He's the biggest star in the world? No.
I think it's impressive that Ed Sheeran can be the biggest star in music in the UK while having pubic hair growing out of his face.
And you know what? Someone said to me, well, David Bowie was ginger and boss-eyed. I was like, yes, and he was also a genius.
Mm.
Whereas Ed Sheeran is not. He's a busker. So I will pick up on his pathetic looks.
I'll tell you what, though. That single that he's got out at the minute, I listened to it and I was like... This is what bugs me about those Emmure and Zeal Ardor type bands. Because, like, Ed Sheeran does that stuff way better than all of those bands.
Yeah.
So all of our bands that try doing that sort of stuff just sound like Lidl versions of what he's doing.
Yeah. And what he's doing is remarkably awful.
Yeah, it's just boring music for boring people, isn't it? Like,
boring.
I don't know when boring became the new black, but...
Yeah.
And here's Stormzy to come along and be awkward.
Yeah.
It was just weird.
I didn't see. I turned off when Ed Sheeran was on. I did see.
Stormzy was on with him.
I know, but I turned off while it before.
Oh, while he was on.
Well, as he was
walking
along.
He walked on,
you
went cheerio.
Yeah. Not in a racist way.
No.
I watched Skepta.
Yeah.
Or, I mean, I didn't get to hear any of it, but.
No, unbelievable. Yeah. It's after 9 o'clock.
There's a girl in our office.
He's only saying, ring, ring, pussy. What's he? He's not. Do you know what I mean?
There's a girl in our office, like, because obviously we do the Brit Awards, and one of the girls came, and she's literally, she's like 26, but she's a Made in Chelsea type.
Yeah.
And she was like, who is this Skepta guy? I didn't even know who he was. Oh, I was in there for Robbie. I was like, you sound like my nan.
The worst.
I was like, you're 10 years younger than me, and you sound like my fucking nan.
Robbie Williams just pisses me off.
I hate him.
No, do you know what it is? Like it was when he was at his absolute peak in the UK, when he was bar none, probably the biggest star we had full stop, let alone the biggest person in music. And we could never get our head around why America weren't interested. Well, like, it's always a big thing in the UK press, isn't it, making it in America. They did the same thing with Oasis.
Yeah.
But in Robbie Williams's case, it was like, they've got Eminem and Usher. And we're sending this Butlin's blue coat.
Yeah.
Like, he's, you know what I mean? He's really good at it, bless him.
Yeah.
Like,
but he is Shane Richie.
He's fucking
he?
Norman Wisdom.
Yeah.
It is what it is. Oh, Mr. Grimsdale, isn't it? Like, it's fucking the geezer's a jester.
And now, fucking Bradley Walsh featuring Prince.
Exactly.
No.
Exactly. And then Robbie gets up.
Shane Richie and Marilyn Manson. It's not going to work.
Robbie Williams gets up and doesn't even do the songs that people know. So even the people that do like him were pissed off of him.
Good. Hope they all fucking melt.
Yeah. Should we talk about heavy metal now?
Yes, please. That's not metal, you podcast.
That's not metal, you podcast. Now step up, Beez, and let the people them know what's going on in the heavy metal world right now.
Got sidetracked there, didn't we? Hello, everybody. Welcome to That's Not Metal, powered by them brilliant folks at Marshall, hashtag live for music. I'm Beez. He is Stephen Hill. Look at him there.
What's happening, everyone? Well, hi, how you doing?
We went off on a tangent there,
didn't we? We started talking about bloody 2 30-somethings don't understand modern pop.
I liked Skepta.
Yeah, I did. Him. Well, what I was allowed to hear of him.
Yeah, I know. Absolute bullshit, right?
Yeah, I know.
I thought it was. It's we've got a question about grime.
Yeah,
coming
God,
up,
we
so
can't
I'll,
carry on talking about the Brits.
No,
today.
God,
fucking
we've
hell.
Already bored everyone to tears.
If you're in Poland watching this, you're going, what are they talking about?
Like
we have this shit thing. We have like a kind of like Smash It's Poland's party with tables over here. It's like the sort of Nickelodeon Awards, but with delusions of grandeur.
Yeah, exactly.
Here in the UK, and it was last night
celebrating all that is. Beige and bland in British music every single year.
Dump a dead sheep on the fucking after party like the KLF did in 1992.
Yeah,
classic.
Bomb the music industry. But we are here to talk about things that are far more exciting because this week we are going to be reviewing the controversial new album from Suicide Silence. It's been a long time coming, this one.
Yeah, really.
I tell you what, man, it really magnifies how big a release this is that everyone's making a massive point of it, of their review, their hot take on the Suicide side. Even Metal Sucks, who are usually like quite sort of flippant and fly by night about things. That's kind of their thing. They're a bit sneery and yeah, whatever. But not to knock Metal Sucks, they're brilliant at it. But like even theirs was like the Metal Sucks review, Suicide Silence. So it's a big one, and we'll be talking about it later on. We're also going to discuss the new albums from Emmure, from Power Trip and Zeal Ardor. And we're also going to tell you all about the Great Metal Summit. That is something that is coming next week. Mm-hmm. And our album club will concentrate on the damn things. We've gone super group mental with Ironiclast.
Have we? Just one?
Two. We did Down last week,
didn't we? Oh, yeah, we have. We've gone mad.
We've gone super group.
Prices are dropping.
Super group bonkers.
Whatever that means.
But I'll tell you, you're a super group. They're not a super group, though. Machine Head, their special is up now on That's Not Metal.net. That was a segue, wasn't it?
Yeah, very good.
We left no stone unturned while going through the band's history, the characters, how the musical landscape shifts around. Machine Head reflected the fortunes of the band. In-depth look at every Machine Head album ever put out and loads more. It was a fucking blast, was it not?
Yeah, it was brilliant. You could say we took all the cliches of Machine Head's career and hit them with a 10-ton hammer.
You could. You could say that.
We took their scars. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what our favourite album is? Just off of those two songs that we've just mentioned.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No shitting. Yeah. So we've done this before. We've done it with Nirvana and Metallica and Slipknot and Pantera and Black Sabbath. So if you're a member, you know what to expect. 4 hours the podcast lasts. It is a no stone unturned celebration. Yeah. Critique.
Machine Head are a fucking wonderful band,
and I feel like this has different connotations no matter where you are in the world, because in the UK Machine Head are massive, always have been, since their first record
day
they've
one
been sizable.
Spom in it,
yeah, Spom, so proud of my moshers. They've always been massive here. I was told reliably, because we put a shout on the podcast saying let us know how big they are where you're from, Australia were like, nope, Australia they're sizable here.
Good.
As well, but yeah, everywhere else it feels like they're less of a thing. So we want to encourage you to get behind Machine Head.
Yeah, because some people might think, we said this on the special, some people might think it's weird that we're picking this like little band.
Yeah.
But it's not.
But then it's not because of the quality of their output.
Yeah.
And it's not because they are massive here in the UK.
Yeah,
so,
they
yeah,
really are.
Machine Head special, 2 parts, over 4 hours, available at thatsnotmetal.net. All right. So I teased it a minute ago. Next Friday, That's Not Metal is going to change for 1 week only, basically because there is fuck all coming out in the albums. So we moved Emmure forward to this week, and next week we are going to do something called the Great Metal Summit, and this is going to involve you. So if you look at the Facebook page now, pinned to our Facebook page, there is a Great Metal Summit poster, and we want your questions underneath it, because what's going to happen is Steve, myself, Metal Hammer editor Merlin Alderslade and our very own extreme metal expert Tom Dare are going to sit and have a debate about the present state of metal, where metal's been over the course of the last 5 years, where metal is going, like can metal ever have a moment in the sun again, what's lacking from metal, why isn't metal seen as dangerous anymore, a whole bunch of this stuff. We are basically going to discuss where metal is at in 2017 and how it moves forward from here.
Mm-hmm.
And we want your questions for it. You know, I know what I think are the important questions to ask. We're all going to be, I mean, we're 4 people with drastically different viewpoints of how we look at heavy metal.
Mm.
I think there's like a very small crossover amongst all 4 of us, which is brilliant. I like the thought of everyone having their say and it getting quite lively. I think this is going to be a lively podcast full of debate, but we want you to go throwing grenades into that. What do you think are the most important challenges facing metal? What questions do you want us to tackle? What subjects do you want us to tackle all about metal? The Great Metal Summit will be happening next Friday on That's Not Metal. Subscribe to us on iTunes and SoundCloud and check out our YouTube page at youtube.com/thatsnotmetalpodcast. That's Not Metal Extra is up as well. Danny Warsnop this week, and next week we welcome Eddie Hamida from Suicide Silence to That's Not Metal Extra. But we'll talk about that a little bit more later on when we talk about the album.
Definitely will.
News. There is virtually fuck all going on in the news this week. I'm not going to even front to you, so we'll just have a quick overview. CKY have reformed.
OK.
Does that mean anything to you, mate?
Not really.
I'm intrigued because we're going to do CKY on Album Club in the next couple of weeks. And I listened to that album last night for what must be the first time in approaching a decade. It's been a long time since I listened to it. And my God, yes. So there was a big reaction to it. Interesting band, very much zeitgeist of the time because it's Band Margera's brother's
it
band.
It was, yeah, yeah.
So yeah, lots to go on CKY, but we'll be doing that in a couple of weeks' time. Merca are working on a new album.
I saw that. That's quite
it's
exciting.
Good news. Yeah. Corey Taylor's new book is going to be called America 51 and is going to be out on August 15th.
Okay.
And Tall Watch. It's back. It's back. No, yeah. You all right?
I know.
Contain yourself.
Yeah.
Maynard James Keenan is working on vocals for the new Tool album, allegedly.
Of course he is.
And this is widespread news this week. There's also a new promo photo from A Perfect Circle. So I'm not sure how much I trust. That
just
like,
absolute shit. Just like conflicting views on all of like... When I've got it in my hand, yeah. I'll believe it. I'm done now.
Done with it.
I'm fucking done with all the... I am fucking done on clicking clickbait where someone goes, someone who used to know the bass player who toured with Tool 15 years ago said he thinks he heard somebody say that they might be thinking about writing some riffs.
Nope.
Fuck you.
Nope. Well, there's very clearly Instagram posts from Adam Jones now, and it's widespread that Maynard is working on vocals. Something's happening.
Okay.
Justin saying that it's in the oven, you know.
But they've been saying all this shit, like, fucking for years. This is not the first time this has happened.
No, nor the second or third.
Not even the ninth. It's been every bloody year.
Modern baseball taking a break, which is a real shame.
Yeah, it is, yeah.
No, I'd heard rumblings through the grapevine that that this might happen, but you always just think to yourself, no, things are going good, like, you know. But if you want to check out the statement, Jake from Modern Baseball made a statement. We know he suffered with his mental health. It was a large amount of the story for Holy Ghost that came out last year and that we raved about. They are one of the standout bands from that sort of DIY fest type scene. I'm gutted about this one because they're a band that have come roaring out the tracks.
Yeah.
Traps.
Having just, you know, the reaction to that tour and then playing those big shows in this country, like really big shows with no support from anyone, really. Like, pretty much, anyway. Present company accepted.
Yeah.
You know, they've done it totally, like say DIY, and it's such a shitter to see that after that effect. I mean, it's horrible to see anyone be affected.
That's it.
So, you know, obviously cripplingly by things that are outside of their control. But you know, particularly for a band who really felt like the forward motion was like
two records in a row,
going, building. Yeah, sucks. Really sucks.
Two records in a row that were really brilliant. And, like, first and foremost, we hope Jake gets well soon. You know, the band schmanned. I hope that dude, like, gets feeling better sooner rather than later. And if he wants to come back to Modern Baseball anytime, we'd all be well grateful. If you haven't checked out Holy Ghost, go and do so. It's fucking brilliant.
Yeah, it's good.
Slam Dunk have also added 10 names. Deaf Havana, Franco Iero and the Patience, We Are the Ocean.
Oh.
Leave it. It's their last ever show.
Last ever show.
So, yeah, the UK mourns.
Yeah.
The Main, Crime in Stereo, Sorority Noise, Too Close to Touch, Waster, Seaway, Boston Manor, and definitely Saving the Best for Last, Stray from the Path.
Yeah.
So, yeah, there's some good stuff on there this year,
decent
I think.
Stuff.
There is, like, maybe not amongst that 10, but if you look at the bill, it's pretty decent this year, Slam Dunk, I think.
Yeah.
Especially if you're our age. I think maybe
and
less
you like
so.
Scar.
For... Yeah, yeah, every year. Every year, guaranteed. And lastly, I do want to actually say something positive about the Brit Awards for acknowledging the work and brilliance and genius of Mr. Tom Searle. That was really fucking great to see. Mm-hmm. So whoever was in charge of that at the Brit Awards, That's Not Metal, our community, architects and all architects fans, thank you for it. It's very well appreciated.
Yeah.
It's a real touch of class, that. So, letters page.
I was going to say, I mean, that's... It's the absolute least.
Yeah, but you wouldn't, you don't expect it from those turns.
No,
do you?
I almost didn't expect it. But I mean, I found the Brits program, and I went and looked for it, and I went solely to go, yeah, you fucking cunts. And then when I saw Tom's name there, I was like, good.
Yeah, it was
like,
it was,
and it should be.
Yeah, very heartwarming to see him in it, put in the company that he deserves to be put in. Brilliant stuff. Letters page then. All right, Philip Rose says, with metal and rock becoming more present in society, as mentioned last week with the Primark t-shirts, uh-huh, do you think we will ever see a proper metal band on the Brits? and who would your pick be to play to give people an idea of where rock and metal is currently? I would love While She Sleeps or Architects, but feel it probably needs to be a more palatable band. Ha ha. Yes, Philip.
Well, Extreme Noise Terror did it, didn't they?
They did.
The only band from our, really, I say from our world.
Yeah.
I mean, Darkness are the only, the Muse did it.
Darkness and Muse.
And Muse, like, obviously, they're a bit embarrassed by us.
Yeah,
like,
that, it feels like rock music wanted to embrace Muse more than Muse ever wanted to embrace rock music, despite them banging on about Rage Against the Machine and all those sorts of bands.
And Rage Against the Machine and the Foo Fighters and and Green Day and various bands have won or been nominated for Brits before. Nirvana won a Brit as well. But when you look at sort of proper rock bands performing at the Brits, Extreme Noise Terror are the single band, the only band that you can really go, well, yeah, them.
And the Darkness.
And the Darkness, of course, and the Darkness.
Like, I think that what the Brits does is the Brits is there to capture what the mainstream is doing as far as music is concerned, right? Like, that's its job. The Brit Awards is basically a reflection of, like, where the tabloid gossip pages are and, like, what's shifting shit tons of records. And it is, I mean, I don't think, like, since I've been into rock music, I got into rock music in 1996, I don't think that rock music in the guise that we view rock music has ever been like the music of choice for Britain's mainstream. And we've said about it before, like, if you look at someone like, I don't know, someone like Ollie Sykes will have like 1.6 million followers on Twitter, and some fucking chancer from some new plastic indie band will have like 20,000 followers, but the tabloids will be all concentrating on this guy because it fits them more. It's never felt like they want, you know, our kind with our tattoos and our loud guitar and our angry music and yada yada yada. It just doesn't feel like,
no.
And so it's hard to imagine the Brits ever putting someone from our world forward without that. Do you know what I mean? It feels like we have to invade the mainstream in a big way to get that.
Yeah. And even if you look at when they did a best rock award for 3 years.
Yeah.
And it was people like Kaiser Chiefs and Hardfi and, do you know what I mean, getting, and the Arctic Monkeys getting nominated for it. So even when they went, oh, we're gonna have an award for rock music, they still weren't even nominating rock bands. So the idea of a metal band playing on their own terms on the Brits,
look at what happened with Iron Maiden.
Yeah.
Like, they put Iron Maiden up for an award, made it fan voted, and we won.
Yeah,
like,
and so
like
James
even
Corden
including
sneered after they won as
but this is just it. Like, Joe Elliott from Def Leppard moved to the States because he was like, well, I can live in Britain and be treated like a joke, or I can go to America and live like a king where they actually value what Def Leppard did and who Def Leppard are. I think Britain in general has a snobby, bad attitude towards rock music in the mainstream. Yep. I mean, you'll know it. If you work with people like in your office, then they will generally make you feel like a dirty grunger because that's just how it is. It's just how we're seen over here.
Yeah.
And it's not the cool thing. They'll fucking wear Ramones t-shirts and then sneer at us for being grungers because they haven't got a fucking clue.
Yeah.
But
I also think, like, in terms of where pop is, like, I only watched a little bit of the Brits yesterday, but from what I've seen from sort of pop artists, I mean, when Extreme Noise Terror were on it with the KLF were a revolutionary act. Like, the KLF fucked, like, were an art project, basically.
Yeah.
They were avant-garde noise terrorists, and they somehow managed to sort of sneak their way into pop culture that they didn't want to have anything to do with. And so their way of kind of their band, as they said, committing suicide, was to bring... I actually read they wanted Motorhead, and Motorhead couldn't do it, so we got Extreme Noise Terror.
Right.
And it's... I mean, you should, if you can find the footage, you should watch it. It's incredible. Mm. And sort of try... But trying to kind of imagine that now, not only do you have to imagine a band like... Nails being asked to go on the Brits.
Yeah.
You also have to imagine a pop act that are willing to say fuck you to the mainstream. I just don't think if there is an electronic dance, if there is an EDM or a hip hop artist or a grime artist who are willing to do that, I'm not sure that the Brits would really take that much of a risk on them.
My gut instinct is that when you talk about Extreme Noise Terror and what they did, if we were to pick 99 out of 100 rock bands that you would pick to put up there, would probably try and fit in.
Yeah.
They would rather try, like, I mean, you see it when bands do live lounge sessions and things like that. Like, bands often do songs that are palatable to a Radio 1 audience, rather than be themselves. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, and I think the Brits would be no different. Like, and to me... Skepta played the Brit Awards last night, right? He did it with minimalist lighting. It looked really impressive from afar, yet it was a really minimalist performance in the way that it looked. And it felt like a fucking atom bomb going off. Like him doing Shut Down compared to fucking everything else that happened all night. It was like, this feels vital and all the rest of it, which is why, like, if you'd have asked me this question... 10 years ago, I'd have gone, yeah, send Gallows. Mm. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You want, if we want our kind represented, who would you send? Send Gallows. So if you ask me that question in 2017, I say send Marmosets.
Yeah.
That's who I would send.
That would be fucking great.
A band that are spontaneous, a band that are loud, that are abrasive, but they are tuneful. They have star appeal cracking off over all the place. Like, to me, if you were going to send a band that's like, it's melodic enough to make, to pique people's ears, but it's confrontational enough. Do you know, they don't know how to play a game. They don't play the media game. They don't play the game in any way. There's a real punk rock aesthetic with Marmosets. And that's who I would send.
Yeah.
Who would you send?
Black Tongue. Fuck those cunts.
Fair enough. Fair enough, straight out of Hull. So Oliver Harper asks for our second question. Considering a lot of people are now saying grime is the new punk and the voice of the young and disillusioned, will punk and hardcore ever come back to claim that, or is grime too big now and punk too underground?
Well, my prediction is, I mean... They said yesterday, oh, the Brits finally embraced grime because they, you know, but it's the same.
Because they nominated them all and then gave all the awards to David Bowie.
Yeah, right. I know. Hey, we didn't realise you were good until you died, you fucking morons.
Yeah.
But I worry in the same way as like what hip hop is now compared to what it was in sort of the early 90s and late 80s. Will grime now have its balls cut off a bit? You know, you saw it happen with Garage a bit, which started with like So Solid Crew and even shit before that and ended up being Craig David, you know, taking the people for a drink on Wednesday.
Yeah.
I wonder if that might happen to grime, which, you know, like, I mean, for our culture.
It happens to everything.
Yeah, of course it does. No,
I mean, we've done a lot on Bush recently.
Yeah.
And that was the accusation of Bush. Yeah. You had Nirvana and you had Mudhoney, and then suddenly you had Gavin Rossdale and Bush.
Yeah.
I get it. I do get it. But, like, I definitely think we are really lagging behind grime in terms of attitude over here. Yeah. Like, if I was young, I would be... If I was 16 now, I would be all about grime because it is angry and it's aggressive and it's aggro and it's punk rock in its attitude. Those people don't give a fuck. Like, if you put them on telly, they're not, like, minding their P's and Q's and being, yes, sir, three bags full, sir. What you get is those people.
Yeah.
Like, straight up. Yeah. And I think that there's an attitude that has to change in rock music. At the risk of repeating myself from the first question, there's an attitude that has to change in rock music. And that is fully like, fuck these people. Mm. Stop trying to fit in.
Yeah.
Stop trying to be nice. Like, rock music is, it's bad. No band that's ever fucking been really great have been stupidly polished.
No.
So, like, in any manner, be that live or in the studio or whatever. And I just think that grime, when I look at it, like, grime has so much about what I love about the rock music we do on this show in it. Mm. Like, and it's getting in the mainstream because it's not that different from hip hop. And hip hop has been the style of music for the last 10, 15 years as far as the mainstream is concerned.
Yeah. But I reckon most of those artists got nominated for the Brits yesterday because it's like, we better nominate them because people think we're all about white people, like they did.
And then they gave the award to Rag and Bone Man.
Yeah, but I saw the programme again, and the front cover of the programme said the most diverse Brits lineup ever. Like, they were basically going, patting themselves on the back just for fucking nominating those people, which is pretty
patronizing.
Fucking pathetic and patronizing. Yeah. But again, like, you look at that and you go, well, it can get popular because I think at the moment, I think rock music is changing, but I still don't see a world in which, like, you know, will ever be relevant or invited, or, you know, like, they kind of invited grime in, and Dermot O'Leary seemed delighted with the idea of these people being at the Brit Awards, you know, because it's cool.
It's almost like that's what he's teleprompted.
I know, right? Yeah. But but you know,
that man does not listen to Kano.
No, he doesn't. No, he's got the Bradley Walsh album though, 100%,
100%,
and
nods from behind the camera here as well. We know this.
But I think it's cool for them to say, oh, look, this is cool, isn't it? I don't know if they'll ever, like you say, even when Iron Maiden won, it cut back to James Corden and him and his fucking little Gavin, whatever his real name is, you know, Gavin and Stacey.
Right, okay.
Like, just sort of went, Iron Maiden, like that. Yeah. And we'll always be that. Whereas grime is like, oh, we like grime as well.
Will we be the edgy type of music again? I think we have to be edgier if that's going to be the case. And I think we're getting there. Let's see, this is the whole point. The point that we make about this shit is coming back is, you know, this podcast has blown the fuck up because you lot believe in the music that we put forward, and we put forward edgy music. Like, there just needs to be more of it. And I hope that, you know, that the example set for, if people are in bands now and they're 13 and they're 14 and they're into Creeper and they're into Milk Teeth and they're into Puppy and all the usual bands that we trot out, Black Peaks and Zokes and all those kind of bands, if they are like those bands, then that's fine. Because there will be, that's the example to follow. They all go against the grain. They all don't sound like each other, but they've all got a kinship with one another. Like, that's the fucking dream. That's what we're after. So I think that grime is just edgier than rock music is in the UK. Like, it just is. Like, you look at their crowds, and their crowds are more dangerous than hardcore shows. Mm. Like, it's that kind of the same thing as like what Rock and Roll Rebellion was in the 50s that led to what the fuck is that when Black Sabbath turned up at the beginning
of
the 70s.
We need to shed these fucking I like beards and I like real ale fucking attitude. Do you know what I mean? Like, that shit is like, no offense to anyone who likes real ale and has a beard, but there are a lot of people who...
I don't know where he's going with this.
Well, you know what I mean? There are a bunch of people who just look back...
I really don't. Go on.
The 80s, these people who go on about, oh, real music and did it. And all they're doing is like going, wah, wah, I want Led Zeppelin and Deep Purple to be around again. And that shit, like, is not helping
I agree. But naturally, grime has not gone to the mainstream. Grime has not been like, oh, please accept us. Grime's just fucking... booted doors down because it's got attitude, and I think that's when it will come.
Yeah.
When people will start really en masse looking at rock music again will be when we are fucking having it again. Mm. And you know, I think that day's coming sooner rather than later. So I do think that we will get more acceptance, but I think grime is what it is. You just got to accept it. It's punk music. It's 1977. Like, it is what it is, and you can't fuck with it. Yeah. Like, in that capacity, what can we do? Well, we can make better music than it for a start.
Yeah.
Like, there's two new bands coming up on today's show that might not be from Britain, but like, you can't say that we ain't giving the world brilliant, challenging, edgy product now. Because rock music is fucking booming again over the course of the last sort of 12 to 14, 15 months. it's been fucking on it.
Yeah, right.
So, you know, the quality will be high and will be edgier. So, like, I mean, why would you book Yumi at six when you can book Ed Sheeran? Do you know what I mean? Mm. Whereas this is something different, all these bands that are coming through now. So, like, Frank Carter and the Rattlesnakes, that's another band that you could put on the Brit Awards.
Yeah.
Put them up there doing Lullaby. Job done.
Mm.
All right. Gregory Fletcher Blanton asks, this is about my move to America, because I wanted to brief a couple of you on this, because there's been loads of questions about it.
Excited?
Yes, very, very. I'm
going to get a tan. Mate, he's going to get a tan.
I'm going to start saying Z instead of Z.
No, don't ever.
I'm not.
Don't you do that.
I'm not at all. My mate, when I was out in LA, my best man lives out there. And when I was out to see him, he said the word bottle. Like, instead of bottle. And when he did it, I just went, no, you're kidding. So, no. But do look out for those idiosyncrasies. And if yeah, I do start... if I start,
them down.
If I start doing them, then by all means, blast me out of the sky. But will the move to LA provide more access to US-based artists for interviews and generally result in more coverage of American artists? Since all rockers these days are going country, will Beez leave That's Not Metal, buy a cowboy hat and start That's Not Country with Danny Warsnop? Well, the latter is definitely not going to happen. will it be provided more access to US artists? Yes. And generally result in more coverage of American artists, no more so than we already do. Mm. The vast majority of bands that we cover are American, because America produces a lot of the world's best rock music, or biggest at the very least.
Yeah.
Although I do think the UK has the best crop of new young bands anywhere on planet Earth.
Yeah.
The idea of going to America is that we can cover things from both sides of the Atlantic. So while Steve's going to shows here, I'll be going to shows in the States, and we'll have loads more that we can cover. You can cover festivals here and in Europe. I can cover festivals there and in America. So everything will be covered by That's Not Metal that needs to be covered. Mm. I can cover Van's Warped Tour every year. You can cover Slam Dunk, Reading and Leeds, Download, Bloodstock, all of these things. In terms of gigs, the Mastodon record comes out at the end of March. I'll be seeing them on April 20th in Hollywood. Mm-hmm. So we'll be able to talk to you about what to expect from the live shows before it reaches you. And on the flip side, when bands tour here, or when bands break in the UK, when I'm finding these bands that are fucking brilliant in the UK, you can tell me what they're like live.
Yeah.
Because I'm either not going to see them, or not going to see them for a couple of years at least. Mm-hmm. So the idea is to give you lot more. That is the idea, that we can just get you more. As well, stuff in the States. You asked me about artists in the States. Yes, we will get American artists out there, but we've also got more chance of getting Biffy Clyro out there, haven't we?
That's true.
Because they're playing to 2,600 people in LA at the end of March, and over here they play to 25,000 people, and they're on ITV and BBC One, so we've got a bit of a job on our hands getting hold of those sorts of bands.
Yeah, yeah.
There are a million reasons why. The YouTube channel is something that someone's voiced concern about. The YouTube channel is going to look better than ever. We have been working on bells.
My face will be smaller, essentially, is what that means.
No, it doesn't, because you don't even know.
Oh,
so,
right, okay.
So it's the look of our YouTube channel will be better than ever before. We've been working on bells and whistles for ages, and the reason that we've not been kind of wheeling them out slowly but surely is because when I go to the States, we want it to look bigger and bolder and flashier and all of those things, so that all of those worries that you might have just get smashed into orbit as soon as you see what we are doing on That's Not Metal. So as far as I'm concerned, when we put this forward, this show together, we want to bring you the best show that we can bring you, and we can do that when we're covering both sides of the Atlantic, because there ain't nothing that we'll miss. Do you know what I mean? Oh, Guns N' Roses are playing the Troubadour to set up for the fucking Once in a Not in My Lifetime tour. I'll be there and we can talk about it.
Yeah.
Like, fucking...
While She Sleeps are playing the old Blue Last. I'll
exactly. Yes. Well, there's,
I mean, yeah.
There's loads of people out there that are like, yeah, you've got the better deal.
Oh, no, I know. Well, mate, I think I have. But just so when I said it, I was like, people going to think that's a...
No, but this is it.
I do.
Hey, man, I'm not here to argue with you. Like, the idea is that. Like, I think a lot of people worry about things. The thing is, when we've done podcasts before, when we've done it remotely via Skype, we've not been looking at each other. That is not going to be the case when we record the transatlantically. Mm. We will be looking at each other because the video, the way that the video is going to work, I'm not going to give anything away, but it involves me and Steve basically hanging like we're hanging now.
We've got a really long bit of string and two massive soup cans. So
yeah, so you can't beat that level of technology. we're going to be able to see each other. We are going to be recording on the same mics that you hear us on now and editing it together that way, whereas before it has been done via computer or sometimes just you on your phone.
This is going to be
a well thought out, well planned thing, as opposed to when we've done it before where it's like,
you're in Austria, up a mountain.
Steve's up a mountain in Austria. Fuck it, we'll get it done. We'll make it work.
Yeah.
So, this is actually well thought out and everything else. I felt the need to say this now because next week is my last podcast in England and we're doing the Great Metal Summit, which is going to be a different sort of show. So while I've got you here and if you've got concerns, just know there is going to be more for you, not less, you absolute group of psychopaths. If we've let you down up to this point in the last 15 months, then by all means, cast doubt, but if we haven't, and I don't feel like we have, we will continue to bring you the very best coverage of rock and metal anywhere on planet Earth. Got it?
Here we go then.
So here we go. I've been waiting. So hold on, right? So we're going to be reviewing the self-titled album from Suicide Silence. It is out this week on Nuclear Blast Record. First, before we go in on this, I want to talk about the circumstances in which we hear these records, because this particular record, I think it matters because it's different to how you lot will have heard this record. So you lot have heard Doris, and then you've heard Silence, and then the records come out, right? Yeah. So you've kind of been lowered down into the volcano that is the new Suicide Silence record. Mm-hmm. Whereas the way it works for us is all of a sudden, ping, your inbox goes and it says, you've got the new Suicide Silence record, to which everything fucking stopped instantly. Whatever I was doing got stopped. Mm-hmm. I got myself some indulgence and cracked on with the Suicide Silence album. And the culture shock is insane. When you are used to Suicide Silence sounding the way that they sound, and you push play, as you know, Doris and Silence are the first two songs on it, but you get hit with this entire body of work at once. So the head fuck of Doris is one sort of level of, what the fuck is this? Like, all of it just coming at once, bam, there it is, there's the fucking record, was a big culture shock, I have to say. Like, I likened it to, if you go to a restaurant for a burger and they bring you calamari, you're kind of, even if the calamari looks all right, you're like, I've come here for a burger, what the fuck is this? And I think that is part of culture shock. It's a head fuck, isn't it?
Have you ever asked for like a Coke or something at McDonald's and picked it up and sucked it and it's a milkshake and you go, oh fuck, I wasn't expecting that?
Yeah.
And you, it tastes horrible because you just weren't expecting it. Like, your initial thing is, oh no.
Yeah.
That's kind of how I felt going.
I won't fucking front on this. Like, the first time I heard it, I was like, the fuck is this? Like, it was, and I think this is, I was going to save this for later on in the review, but I guess I'll do it now. I feel for Suicide Silence to a little extent, right? As we've said, when it comes to 21st century metal, Suicide Silence are one of the standout bands for it. And there aren't many standout bands playing just straight up face melting metal. Like, no bells, no whistles, no fucking, I know that a lot of people like, the word deathcore has come up for Suicide Silence, but I haven't seen them as a deathcore band for, I mean, Jesus, it's No Time to Bleed at the latest. Mm-hmm. I just haven't seen them that way. So, I don't think that it's kind of fair that Suicide Silence are slapped for stepping away from that stuff.
No.
The reason why I was so bummed out about it, and I still am to a certain extent, is that there's no one else to pick up that mantle. And that's not Suicide Silence's fault.
No.
It's not like, well, so what, we have to do that shit forever just because no one else is up to that level. There are good bands in playing straight up metal. But one of the standout ones that you go, yes, they are sizable as a band. They are brilliant creatively. They've just Eddie Hameda joining Suicide Silence, and what he brought vocally to You Can't Stop Me was a really exciting jump off point for me. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You were ready for what comes next. And this is a very different sort of record.
Yeah.
Like 70% clean vocals was the word that came out of the campfire even before we heard it. So we knew it was going to sound slightly different.
Yeah.
Ross Robinson's producing it, so you know he's going to have a stamp on it. Mm-hmm. But the 70% clean vocals, people automatically assume that it's a cash grab.
Yeah.
Right, that's instantly. Like, you think that they're going to turn up sounding like the fucking The Amity Affliction. Or, like, do you know what I mean? Not maybe, obviously not that far, but, like, I don't know. Like, Miss May I, say. Mm. Like, a heavier band that have clean vocaled choruses. Yeah. That's where your mind naturally goes. And this is not a cash grab by any stretch of the imaginations, because this is a fucking weird record.
Oh, there's no way anyone... if anyone wants to throw the term sellout about... that shows a massive lack of understanding of what this record is, because there's no way in the world that this is a sellout. It's lots of things, but it's not a sellout.
No,
it's not a sellout. It's not a compromisation. It's not an attempt to appeal to a greater level of people. But not even slightly.
And if it was, it's fallen flat on its ass, because look at the reaction to Doris, and like the fact that the reason why we say this is a controversial thing is because we discussed it on the show the other week. There's even been a petition that's signed by over 5,000 people saying that they didn't want this album released.
The guy who made it. So, it was a joke. I was only joking. It was just a joke.
I saw him. Like, yeah. Yeah. But the thing that self-important arsehat doesn't seem to understand is that it's not about you who made the petition in the first place. It's about the fact that 5,000 people have signed that very petition, and it's like that's entitlement on a whole new level.
Yeah.
But anyway, like that's an issue that we've done before.
Yeah.
So Ross Robinson, how much is Ross and his personality culpable for what's gone on this album?
A lot.
I think so too.
Loads. I think...
Tell people what Ross Robinson's characteristics are as a bloke in the studio.
He's a weird guy, and he pushes bands emotionally and physically into places that they might not have been comfortable in going.
Slipknot will tell you stories about having oranges thrown at them while they're trying to have takes done on the self-titled Slipknot record. Jonathan Davis was actually physically tortured by Ross while he was doing his vocals. Yeah. Ross, in the very best way, because I love his punk rock energy and spirit, is a freak.
Yeah, he's a loon.
Yeah.
And he... but he has a way. I always thought the thing that I love Ross Robinson. I love many, many of the albums that he's done.
Plus one.
And I always think what Ross Robinson can do, which is something that we said about Rick Rubin as well, is that he can look at a band and he can see who that band really are. And he can see like deep into the psyche of what that band is. And he can extract the raw elements for the best of what that band is.
You say can do that, I say could do that.
Okay, well, yeah, spoiler alert. He did it with Korn, he did it without the drive-in, he did it with Glassjaw, did it with Slipknot. He's done it with lots of bands. And even
the most recent of those bands, 17 years ago now.
Yeah, well, and, you know, he's made lots of great records.
Oh, undeniably.
I even was like, I know you're not a fan, but I even... liked the attempt to what they did with the Cancer Bats record. I still like that record.
I know. And part of what you liked about it was Ross.
Yeah.
And what Ross brought
was,
to
yeah,
the table.
Yeah. This is the first time I've listened to a Ross Robinson album and gone, does Ross get this band? I don't know if he gets this band. I'm not sure.
Well, this is it. Like, I think that is a double-edged sword of an answer that I'm going to give. If it seems like we're sitting on the fence now, it's because we're just laying the land before we get to opinion. I think that Ross is a nutcase. Like, the fact that like you hear those asides in the background, or like you used to hear on those old Ross Robinson records. So like before the first riff kicks in on Doris, you hear someone going "Fuck yeah!" Like those sort of things. I think that Ross encourages a band to explore the space that they want to explore, which is why I don't think it's as much about whether Ross gets Suicide Silence. It's just that where Suicide Silence wanted to go, Ross pushes that thing to 11.
Yeah.
So if you want to go and you mentioned about the Cancer Bats record, and what you liked about it was that, like, no, this is a proper hardcore record, right? That was your go-to thing when we spoke about it, was this is a proper hardcore record for people who like proper hardcore.
Yeah.
And what I mean by that is Cancer Bats were heading in that direction, so Ross took them all the way there, all or nothing. And God bless Ross Robinson for that. Like, in a world where people just want to fit in and be mollycoddled and all the, and like half-hearted about things, Ross Robinson is all chips in on everything he does. And so if this album is a misstep creatively, and that's the direction that Suicide Silence have want to go. And I don't think it is entirely. And Suicide Silence have been like encouraged to go there to the nth degree by their producer. I think that is the kind of thing where Ross Robinson comes into play.
Yeah.
Like the very obvious comparison to bring in at this time is Machine Head, is it not?
Mm-hmm.
Like, Machine Head were a band that were beloved by the metal masses, certainly in the UK, as we've already discussed. They were known for this groundbreaking metal style at which they excelled at. And then Ross Robinson and them went in a new metal direction. And when those things went that way, it's one of the reasons why Burn My Eyes hasn't dated. Burn My Eyes and The More Things Change haven't dated as much as The Burning Red have, despite being older.
Yeah.
Because that was it. That was the zeitgeist sound that they were going for at the minute, was that Ross Robinson sound, and he took Machine Head there to infinity and beyond.
Mm-hmm.
In Suicide Silence's case, let's get into the fucking record then. I think that when it goes in the direction and they get it right, it is interesting.
Yeah.
I think when it goes in the direction that Suicide Silence have wanted to go and it goes badly, it goes horrifically. There are some moments on this record where, and like, I get it. Like, it's this whole fucking punk rock energy thing and you just don't get it, man. Like, that kind of attitude, but I mean, it's hard to look at, what's that song near the end? Conformity.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of, when we look at Eddie's vocals, the two main vocalists that come to mind are Mike Patton and Chino Moreno, with the new things that he's doing. You could have played me Dying in a Red Room, right? You could have played me that song and gone, you have 20 guesses to guess who this band are before this record dropped. And I wouldn't have come up with Suicide Silence. It literally does not sound like that band.
No, not in the slightest.
Like literally unrecognizable. And it's a hard right. Do you know what I mean? Like, especially when Suicide Silence are 4 for 4, 4 great records. The last two, particularly brilliant. Like, first two, promise and potential. And the last two, absolute home runs. Yeah, I think that When this album goes in, the problems as a listener is when you take a hard right, it takes a lot to get that hard right. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like, to really get it over with people. And there are moments that I'll get to later on this record that I think show real promise.
Yeah.
But, I mean, Doris still makes me laugh every time I hear it. I have to say, like, whenever that chorus comes in, I'm still, like, and I've had this record for, like approaching 3 months now, and it still makes me chuckle every time it comes in. It's just like, that is so bonkers. That vocal line is so, like, where did that come from?
Yeah.
So is the issue that is the main issue with this album that it's so unrecognisable from the Suicide Silence that we've known up to this point?
I think...
Is that the main issue?
If you remember, the first thing I messaged you and went, this is shit, isn't it?
It was.
Literally within about a week, not even a week, a couple of days of having it.
Yep.
I was like, this is shit, isn't it?
That was your exact wording, mate.
And I mean, you have no idea how much I've listened to this record. I have listened to it so much because I so want to understand it. Oh, I am so fucking desperate to understand it. And I've got to the point where, with you, where it's now I'm sort of used to the sound. I feel like I've got a slightly better understanding of the record. Like, I feel like, I think they're deliberately trying to, this to me feels like a deliberate attempt to alienate people. Like, in a lot of ways, I think they're doing stuff.
You think this is purposefully obnoxious?
Yeah. Because, do you know what? I feel like they would have seen the scene that they've come from, and Deathcore, I know someone said the other day on our YouTube channel, Deathcore's been in the shitter. Yeah, it has. It's formulaic. I saw Chelsea Grin the other week. It was so boring and so crap and so fucking derivative that I was like, no wonder they want to step as far away from being grouped in with those bands as they possibly can. Mm. I can kind of understand them wanting to alienate those people. And I also think that you might look at metal and go, what else can be done? Like, what else in our scene and the things, like, what can we do? And I think, you know, this is not like the Code Orange album where they try a load of stuff and they're really fucking good at it.
Yeah.
This is like them trying a load of stuff and occasionally going, we'll put a whistle on at the end because that'll make people, we'll call this song Doris.
They know what they're doing.
Yeah.
In like, so the album itself ends with someone whistling.
Yeah, it's Eddie.
It's the fucking Muppets theme tune, isn't it? For a half a second before it changes slightly so they don't get sued.
Yeah.
So it's not like they don't know they're fucking with people. Yeah. Like, come on, it's there, front and centre. It's not like they're hiding with it. I know that but I don't think that they've done it to be obnoxious. Like, the defiant statements coming out of the Suicide Silence camp, I think, are great. Mm. I think that they believe in this wholeheartedly and that they've been greeted by a shitstorm and they've gone, I don't give a fuck. We love this record and we believe in it. I think that's brilliant. It goes to show, again, that whole fucking cash grab thing.
Not at all.
No chance whatsoever.
But when I say they've been obnoxious and they're trying to annoy people, I kind of mean, like, they've made this record and, you know, the thing with Ross Robinson is he would have got them down in the room and gone, like, who are you? What? And they would have gone, right, well, when we were growing up, like, these are people who probably, like, you know, I spoke to Mark before and he says how much he loves System of a Down and, you know, they probably grew up listening to death metal bands and new metal bands and that's really what, you know, deathcore is like now, wouldn't it? But finding a way of doing that but it not really sounding like the typical deathcore thing, and, you know, being sloppy, being really fucking sloppy. Mm. And, you know, like the bit in, what's the song, track number 6, where it just all collapses around itself. Hold Me Up, Hold Me Down.
Where it literally just sort of
collapses down all over itself and just is loads of horrible, obnoxious, like nasty, tuneless noise that goes on and on and on and on. You go, embrace this and accept it for what it is and go, oh, I really love the fact that they're brave enough to do that on a record, or go, it's not really a song, it doesn't work for me. And I'm still,
I fit somewhere between those two things.
So do I.
I think that, like, I admire the fact that they've tried to do something else, right? There's never a problem. It's never a problem to see a band stepping outside of their comfort zone and trying to do something like more ambitious than what they've done before. But it's a sinister album. It's a twisted album. It's noisy. It's chaotic. It's not like they've suddenly started, like, it's a fucking weird art metal record.
Yeah.
It's really fucking weird. Like, there's so much that's out of left field. I know, I said Dying in a Red Room, like, it's just mental. It just sounds like Saturday Night Wrist era Deftones, like Beware, that sort of thing. And then the outro of the song is just, like, odd drum patterns, Eddie wailing like Jonathan Davis used to at the end of, like, old school Korn songs, like, guitars doing really weird shit, a phaser-based chord progression. Like, it is all this going on at once. It is a fucking weird, noisy, chaotic, avant-garde metal record. Mm. It's just that they were so good at being that straight up metal band.
They were.
So I think that where this suffers more than anything else is that I don't think it's as good as the last two records. Right. And I think it's noticeably not as good as the last two, because the last two have been absolute ragers. Do you know what I mean? There's no shame in that.
Yeah.
We could have been saying that if they'd have stayed in the same direction.
Yeah.
Like, you know, time has definitely mellowed me.
Yeah, me too.
Because the first time, I think that people would have been expecting us to go two studs up on it. And to me, I've almost been put off by the reaction online, by all these entitled whingy fucks going like, you can't change. No, you can change. Mm. Like, I'm only interested in the quality of those changes. And the way I have decided to look at this record is that this is their first attempt. Attempt at doing something like this, right? Mm. So if you look at the growth from the Cleansing to the Black Crown, or to You Can't Stop Me, right? They're all in the same ballpark, but they just improved more and more and more, right? Mm. If you think of this album as the Cleansing, there are moments on here that suggest there could be a future in this realm for them. I think Silence is really good.
Yeah, I do. I really like that.
I think the chorus of Run is fucking mm-hmm. huge. Mm-hmm. What else have I got written down here that I like? I like Hold Me Up, Hold Me Down that you mentioned earlier, because it's vicious and it's avant-garde. And Don't Be Careful, You Might Hurt Yourself as well, because the heaviness is still there. Mm. It's not like it's not even like it's a less heavy record, although I guess it is. It is a less heavy record, but when it gets
really, it's a different sort of heavy, isn't it?
Yeah, but when it gets heavy, it gets fucking nihilistically, like fucking violently heavy, like it does on that last song. But you know,
you need to give this album your time.
I think that this is. I wouldn't go as far as to call it a failed experiment, because there are those moments that I've just said about that, like, suggest that if they continue in this direction, that there could still be greater rewards to be had. I'm not saying they're fucking mental idiots for doing this, and they, like, this is what I first thought. Like, they're mental idiots for doing this. Oh my God, like, I love these people as people. They're like some of the best people going, but I don't understand what they are doing here at all. Two, there are a, you know, that's four songs. Four songs out of nine, that I think are all right, which is not a disaster.
No.
And it's a new experiment that they've tried. I think that it's just, there are so many, do you know what I mean? I don't know if you've already seen, like, Eddie's getting pelters for the thing. Yeah, like,
yeah, of course.
But, like, and that's that I understand it. And I get why people are mad, and like the fact that we are called That's Not Metal to poke fun at people that demand things are a certain level of metal. Mm. I only care about quality, and this is a dip in quality from the last two records, but that's to be expected, because the last two records have come in an area where they have found what works for them, tweaked it and manipulated it, and bang. Mm. Do you know what I mean? It's rare that someone does a black album. Do you know what I mean? Does a hard right and gets it 100% right. When they take this record on tour for a year and they start sussing, because they're already, I think there's like five songs that are in the set already, including some of the weird ones.
Yeah.
Dying in a Red Room, Hold Me Up, Hold Me Down are both in the set lists that they've been playing in the States at the moment. So the thing to think is, do they have the potential to make this kind of shit better than it currently is? And I think they do. I think there are moments on here that suggest, do you know what I mean? If they improve upon Silence and that chorus in Run, like those real, like the moments where you go, that's really good, that. If they improve upon that, there is still a bright future for Suicide Silence in that realm. I just think that they got so good at what they were doing, and there was still more scope over there. There was still more terrain to be explored for me in where they were on the Black Crown and You Can't Stop Me. Especially,
but maybe they felt like they, you know, like you can't, that's, we can look at it and go, you know, but if they don't want to do it, they don't want to do it.
No,
and they obviously don't want
to
do it.
And it wouldn't be good if they were forcing it.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
If they felt the need to do this, like, I always back a band for doing, like, you've always got to do what you want to do. No great fucking music is made by, like, going, well, these people in the 16 to 23 demographic like us, and we have a mainly male fan base, so that maybe we should aim at, yeah. Like, anyone who thinks about music in that way never gets it right, never does anything truly great.
Yeah.
Like, so I applaud them for it, but it's just the quality is not as high doing this sort of thing as it was on the last two records doing what they were doing
that
before.
That being said as well, though, I think you should give it enough time to let yourself become accustomed to it.
Because you're not going to get it the first time.
Nobody's going to listen to this first time and go, oh, okay.
No one will. I think there's more chance of people doing that because they weren't thrown in at the deep end like we were. Like, it wasn't just like, here it is all at once. Like, people have had full 6 weeks to prepare for this. Like, they've had Doris and they've had Silence. So, and they, you know what, like, while there's still shit tons that you ain't heard yet, like, people can be prepared for it. Yeah. So I think it will take less to get into, other than, like, the way that we got it and pushed play and was like, wow, is
but
this?
You will need to commit a lot of your time to it, I think. Like, yeah. You will have
to. Does that suggest that this is, like, forced-like?
No. I think what it is... like you say, the initial shock of it was so strong that that's all you had. If your initial reaction to something is just, I can't believe it, then it's like you said when you watched Metallica and Lady Gaga at the Grammys, your initial reaction was just, I'm furious that the mic didn't work.
Yeah.
So,
and
you were kind of clouded.
They didn't get introduced, yeah.
Yeah, and your judgment is slightly clouded by it. I think if you press it and you're like, I'm going to fucking, what is this going to be?
Yeah.
Or whatever. Because by this point, I'm now used to it and I can hear the bits that sound like Suicide Silence to me. When I first listened to it, like you rightly said, I go, this is not the same band. It's not even the same fucking band. And that is the overriding emotion. Yeah. And it's not, I mean, even if it did sound like them, but it was weird as it is, like, I would say this about any album that had a song as weird as Hold Me Up, Hold Me Down.
Yeah.
Because it's weird.
And Doris's as well.
They're just weird. Yeah. It's a weird album.
It is. Like, the amount of times in my notes that I've written the word weird, if you want to get a real good example of how weird it is, like close your eyes when you're listening to it and isolate yourself in on the guitars. Right, because the guitars do such weird shit on this, and weird effects, and all that sort of thing. And, like, you know, it feels like band and producer in tandem going down a rabbit hole together and not slowing down, like not dipping their toes. Like, if there's a lake of new creative ideas, they haven't gone, all right, well, maybe we'll just go up to our knees. They've gone cannonball, bitch, and gone flying into it.
Yeah,
like that's what you've got here.
Yeah,
it's all in.
It reminds me of, in terms of like a massive sonic turn and something, it reminds me of like Entombed, one of my favourite bands.
Mm-hmm.
Like after Nick Anderson left and they did To Ride Shoot, Straight and Speak the Truth. At that point, four albums of rumbling death metal. He leaves and they make Same Difference, which is an album of kind of post-rocky slint and like unsaney stuff. And my initial reaction to it is just, eh? This doesn't sound anything like you. Like, I don't get it. And, like, you shouldn't be doing this. That whole thing. Like,
but that's different because it's enforced by a member change.
Well, it's still, whatever. You still put the CD on and go, here's the new Entombed. I know what I'm expecting.
Right.
And what I was expecting was not that. And so it took me a long time. And this is like getting it as a 17-year-old. So I think if younger people, they get more like, they cling harder to what a band is a lot of the time, I think. I know I did anyway. And it took me a couple of years before I just sort of appreciated it for what it was. Mm. And I think people are going to have to not hug Suicide Silence so tightly as they have been before, because...
Yeah, but I can understand it if they do. I could understand someone listening to this record and going, I just wish they sounded like they did before. I can understand that too. Because they were so good at it, I can understand that too. But...
That ain't coming back, I don't think.
No, we'll get more from that on Tuesday on That's Not Metal Extra when you take these views to Eddie Hameda.
Yeah.
The best is yet to come if they're going to do this sort of thing. It is not a disaster, but it is a slight step down, just for me. That's for me. Like, I would be... it would be too extreme the other way to go, no, this is still as good as the Black Crown and you can't stop me. Mm. But at the same time, it is nowhere near as bad as everyone's making out. No. Like, I think that the disappointment is that it's a 6 out of 10 record from Suicide Silence. Yeah. I think that they are a victim of, on this particular record, I think they are a victim of the standards that they've set themselves. But this is the first time at a new experiment, and bands don't get it right first time. And I'm very, very intrigued to see what Suicide Silence do next. If they can find that formula, honestly, the chorus of Run to me is the bit where I go, that's it. Mm. That still sounds heavy, but it's melodic and it's weird and all the rest of it. Like, all the best traits of this album can be found on the chorus of Run to me.
Come back to me in a year, because I have no fucking idea at the moment. What I will say is I think it's definitely worth you listening to a lot.
Oh, you have to. You have to. Yeah. It's one of the year's essential listens. It is the self-titled album from Suicide Silence, out now on Nuclear Blast. And don't forget to subscribe on iTunes and SoundCloud, because this coming Tuesday, Mr. Stephen Hill in conversation with Eddie Hameda. I cannot wait to hear it myself. All right, next album is Emmure. Back with a new album called Look At Yourself. So after making waves early on, Emmure, about a decade ago, go on.
Look at yourself, bruv.
Look at yourself is the name of this album. After making waves early, like kind of being thugged out, almost sort of Limp Bizkit of deathcore. I don't say that as an insult. I just mean that it's all about bounce and fucking obnoxious and getting people amped. They've spent the better part of the last 4 or 5 years being a bit of a punchline, all in told, from the fucking having a song on the last record that they wanted to call Bring a Gun to School, to Frankie Palmieri's daft shirts that he brought out with ridiculous things on them. Like, I think it was like screenshots from Columbine and shit like that on it. Yeah. But like, so basically this is a fascinating story though, Emmure, because the entire band walked out on him.
Yeah.
Left just Frankie, and he's Frankie and a bass drum on his back.
Frankie
says, on your Todd. So Frankie was left on his own. And Emmure are back now with members from technically minded bands, Glass Cloud and the Tony Danza Tap Dance Extravaganza. Steve, have you got any real reference points with Emmure?
I saw them live a few years ago, and I have heard various songs of theirs, but it all just blended into one big sort of, like,
well,
angry mess, didn't
that
it?
Will be, because that's what they do. They are they're a very one-dimensional band, Emmure, which is why it's so intriguing that they've taken on an all-new band full of members from tech metal bands.
It is, isn't it?
So it's it made me very intrigued to see where Emmure were going to go, and I have to say, it's a step up from where they've been recently, but it's fucking Emmure. Like, it still sounds like Emmure. It's still based around Frankie Palmieri's sort of rap cum growl
delivery. He doesn't give
a fuck, does he?
Well, he says that a lot.
Well, you know, I don't think he does, genuinely, but
no.
I
just don't think you need to keep saying it.
But yeah, no, but it's their shtick. Yeah. It's what they do. Like, they're not sort of suddenly sounding like After the Burial.
No.
Just because they've got tech-minded guys in the band. But it is definitely slicker musically than where they've been in the past.
It's really not that bad.
It's much better than I thought it would be.
Yeah,
I was ready to...
Yeah,
go.
I mean, it's
go
far, but like
up.
You know, when we talked about Attila, like, I think it's, again, obnoxious is such a great word for Emmure. I mean, he is. Have you ever interviewed him before?
Yeah, loads of times.
Have you? Yeah. He, I wouldn't say he comes across as particularly as a nice guy, but he seems like he was pretty. You know, I expected him to be a bit of a like loopy sort of snotty twat, and he was fairly sort of normal and courteous and everything.
He's normal and he's courteous, but there's definitely something weird going on there, man.
Yeah, he refused to answer a question I asked him, which was like, you know, like when you go, what sort of crisps do you like? No, I'm not answering that. Right. I was just like, why? Okay.
Yeah.
like, why are you getting shitty about that?
Yeah.
And yeah, and his personality is it's just the it is the overriding stamp on this record. Like it is so Frankie Palmieri that I think whoever you got in the band, you could get fucking Dream Theater with Frankie Palmieri fronting them, and it would still sound like a man in a baseball cap and a windbreaker walking down the road, tweeting how much he doesn't give a zero fucks given, etc. etc.
No, I totally agree.
Like, do you know what I mean?
I totally agree.
Yeah,
but it is definitely slicker. The thing about the thing about Emmure, and I think why they become such a punchline over the course of the last 4 or 5 years, is that their music always sounded like a high school band. Like their first rehearsal, in that the music was incredibly basic and rigid and lumpen, and do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It they always felt like a secondary school band. Like there's not a lot of musical ambition.
No.
There's not a lot of musical complexity or interesting ideas or concepts. It was just like basic Neanderthal juvenile rage.
And sometimes that feels good.
Dude, but this is it. This is what happens with me and Emmure every single time. Do you ever take a bite of something and you go, that is fucking awesome, and 2 bites later it is sickly as fuck? Like, you're just like, oh, I can't eat any more of this because it's so much. Like, I don't know, too rich, too sweet, too whatever.
Yeah.
And that's how I feel about Emmure, right? Emmure starts, like, the first single from this album is called Flag of the Beast. It's the standout track on it. It starts with an opening quote from Private Parts, the Howard Stern movie as well.
I knew where it was from.
There you go. Yeah. It's Paul Giamatti from Private Parts.
Yeah.
So it goes on regularly in our house. Yeah. I heard this as a single and was really taken aback. I was like, that's really fucking great. Like, I would go as far as to say great. And I do the same thing with Emmure every time. You hear the first song and you go, I like that. Like someone who likes Biscuit and who likes Bounce and who likes obnoxious things, and it's not mollycoddled at all. Do you know what I mean? They make Attila sound like the Kings of Leon. Like, but by 4 or 5 songs,
13 tracks
is too much, isn't it? And we're talking about 13 songs where only one song is longer than 3 minutes 10 seconds. Like, this is it. They know their limitations. They don't overstay their welcome with this shit. They're not stretching this stuff out to 6 minutes anymore. They are what they are, unapologetic. If you like Emmure, this is the best Emmure record for fucking years and years and years, right? If you are one of those people that you like Emmure, this is a home run for you. And I have to say, in thinking that we were going to, like, ha 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 ha, Emmure, not at all. Like, I just think it's too basic for today's, for where we are right now in rock music. With all this fucking interesting, great stuff going on. We just spoke about how avant-garde Suicide Silence's record is for 20 minutes. Like, there's loads more interesting going on. Good and bad. Like, whatever you think of the Suicide Silence record or whatever, there is a lot of interesting stuff going on, and Emmure are still here being Emmure. Like, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I do know,
like,
what I mean.
Like, so, like, but it's a better version of it, and if you like Emmure, you will be stoked.
Yeah,
are ultimately Emmure. Still here being Emmure, not giving a fuck, and making beatdowns.
Mm.
Like,
that's it, really.
Nothing more, nothing less.
Yeah.
But it sounds good. It's produced well.
Yeah,
it's played well. It's got a bit more.
Nice,
it's got, like, a bit more going on rhythmically than what they've had in the past.
That's true.
But I mean, like, it's literally like fucking. I used this quote before, but like from The Simpsons, it's Malibu Stacey's got a new hat. Yeah. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, fine. Right, it's another Emmure record.
Yeah, it's getting deleted off my phone the second I leave this place. It's never going to get listened to.
So what
again,
did you openly dislike it or what?
No, I thought it was. It outstayed its welcome, but at the start I was like, oh yeah, okay, fine.
Yeah,
he annoys me a bit. Like, it is a bit tiresome listening to, because everyone now is like, oh, snowflake, liberal, I don't give a fuck, oh, butt hurt, and I'm just like, you got burnt, all this shit. I am a little bit like by that whole thing now.
It is a little bit like the level of aggression on it is not someone walking into your front room and punching you in the face. It is a little kid going past in his mum and dad's car, looking at you, poking his tongue out and putting his middle finger up at you.
Yeah.
Like going, you out of the window. It's that level of obnoxious and less so like genuine danger at this point. It's very cartoony.
Yeah, it's but true.
It's Emmure being Emmure, and God bless them for it.
Yeah, fair play, lads.
So there you go, Emmure's new album. It's called Look at Yourself. It's pretty uninspiring, but if you like Emmure, like this is definitely the best version of Emmure for a long, long time.
I think that's true.
And a massive step up from where they were on that last couple of records.
Yeah.
So let's move on to something completely different. Mm-hmm. The first truly great new band of 2017 is here. Zeal and Ardor is a project that both yourself, uh-huh, myself, and Merlin Alderslade, when it came to our editor of Metal Hammer, when it came to the 2017 preview, it was the only act that all three of us had on our list, mm-hmm, as new bands to look out for this year. I'll give you a bit of backing on it before we start going in on the record itself. It is a one-man project from Manuel Gagneau. It's still a band sound, like he just plays everything on it. The live band is apparently going to be a six-piece with including two backing singers.
Oh, I think we need that, yeah.
Yeah, it's going to be brilliant. According to the feature that ran on The Independent this week from our good friend Mr. Renfrey Deadman, in a bid for songwriting inspiration while working on his chamber pop project Bird Mask, he would go onto 4chan and ask people to combine two styles of music, and he'd write a song in that style in half an hour. So if someone said polka and jazz, he'd write a polka jazz song in half an hour. If you said fucking, I don't know, novelty thrash metal, he would make a novelty thrash metal song. And someone asked for sort of Afro-Caribbean chain gang chanting and black metal, and thus Zeal and Ardor was born. Chain gang chanting is where I'm going to start this,
yeah,
because it is, we have so many great records that we've been lucky enough to bring you on this show, but very few in 15 months that you can call true originals. You know, the reason why we both went mad about the Oathbreaker record last year was because it was so interesting and it was so original, and it opened up new creative doors for rock and metal, because all of those people that go, all the best ideas have already been done, just get shown up for the ignorant pricks that they are when, yeah, an album like Oathbreaker turns up. And Zeal and Ardor is the same.
Exactly.
Chain gang chant. It is such an interesting, soulful element to throw in to metal.
And he excels at that in terms of, like, you know, the 50-50 split between the metal and the sort of the blues. And it's not even a 50-50 split between those two things. I think, you know, we haven't even got into the use of electronics and the use of,
God, no,
sort of, like, you know, programming and all these kind of little, like, the kind of the almost orchestral bits in it as well.
But this, like, this album combines bits of Muse, black metal, avant-garde and hooks. It's got hooks for days. That's why we're going to start with that chain gang chanting, because, yeah, this is not pretentious. Like, these sorts of things, when you describe them, sometimes, and because, you know, we have a highbrow the way that we look at music, we've just kind of sneered at Emmure a bit.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? We do have a slightly highbrow way of looking at music, but I don't see this as a pretentious, like you need a developed palette to get it band, because the melodies on those chain gang chants are so infectious and undeniable.
Yeah,
really undeniable is the word that I would use. I don't understand, like, if someone listens to, like, Leon Bridges, I don't, like, I would expect them to be able to get what's going on here. It's just that it appeals to us, because not only is it these unbelievably, like, mainstream level brilliant hooks in that style, it's just added with added edge from our world and from fucking black metal and lo-fi recording. And I mean, this is one of the most exciting bands of the last couple of years.
It's mental. And you're not lying either. It's the sort of thing that at times you could put it on and go, it's got nothing to do with metal. It's got literally not
the opening song.
The opening song, nothing to do with metal, but still dark and infectious and brilliant. And when it gets really exciting is when he uses like Children's Summon, where he uses like the voice of the sort of chain gang stuff, but in a black metal way. So that kind of like the Behemoth, Rotting Christ type, you know, chanting, you know, that and that kind of ritualistic chanting that you expect from those bands, done in that way. I mean, it's not like, oh, here's a bunch of riffs and some guy going, like, you know, doing sort of Johnny Hooker.
Because you're going to move on from something that really interesting point on. When you were saying about the chanting and used in a kind of more metal way. According to that same independent feature, which is well worth a read, he started putting the music together and the images in his head that started to form were African chain gangs rebelling against their Christian captors by invoking Satan.
Yeah, amazing.
But like, so even just as a captivating mental image, what you're saying about that stuff is exactly what he was going for. That was the aim, was to make that style, but blend it into something evil sounding. And that evil sound is lo-fi black metal. The whole thing is lo-fi. He got a shit microphone, with way too much signal showing, to get that kind of lo-fi recording sound that makes it sound like those chants are straight out of the 30s and 40s.
Yeah.
I mean, this is a fucking worldie, I think. I really think.
And the things as well, was it like 8 songs, 9 songs, 25 minutes long? It is over so quickly, you just go, oh God, I could have stayed. Like, the absolute flip of what we were saying about Emmure.
Mm.
25 minutes of this is not enough. It is not enough.
It is such a brilliant, tantalising starting point for the Zeal Ardor project.
Yeah.
And the thing is, I think that generally, the first track will decide whether this is for you or not.
Yeah.
Like, if that fucking soul and hook can't get you, and I find it very hard to believe that it won't, because it's so... undeniable is the word that I keep using. There's the title track. The way that this record comes flying out of the gates in such different kind of ways. You got the title track opens it with that chain gang chanting, but then it gives way to In Ashes, which is like blasts of like double kick drum and like fiery flashes of fucking black metal. And there's a lot of Matt Bellamy to his guitar playing to me.
Yeah.
There is a lot of Muse on this record. And then it goes into this kind of lo-fi chant with bass dance orientated interlude. That's the third track. And then the fourth track is when it goes fully Muse. It is like Muse playing black metal with chain gang chanting. Like, just even throwing that out there as a concept is fucking mental.
Yeah,
but
nuts.
That's what it sounds like, and it's not up its own arse. This is anyone can get it.
You could challenging
as fuck, but anyone can get this because of those melodies.
It'll take you a while to go, eh? But I bet you'll sing the chorus. Like I say, you'll sing the chorus first time over.
Yeah.
As soon as it comes back, second listen, you'll go, that chorus is in my head, and you'll be like going, a dead boy is a dead boy.
Yeah.
A good boy is a... You'll be doing it. You definitely will, because, mate, this is pretty fucking special.
Yeah, there's no denying it.
Like, and I think this, like you say, this is just the start. 25 minutes, I want to hear, like, I know this is an album, this is definitely an album, but where he goes on album 2 or 3, like...
The beauty is...
I think there's so much more, like, potential with him to do more.
I think this album actually came out a year ago. It was just bought by someone and is now being released again.
Really?
Which, to me, suggests that we shouldn't really have to wait that much longer for another album. By that, I mean that, like, next year we'll probably get another one.
Yeah.
Like, unless this project goes supernova. But, yeah, as far as bands that we've brought to the show, this is a special band. I don't think, like, that we haven't even touched. There's a track that is double bass led.
Yeah.
Like, as in not double bass drum on the drums. Like, I mean, like, actually
Louisiana
up,
jazz.
Stand up. Double bass sounds like fucking Tom Waits through a Mike Patton filter. I know Patton hasn't come up for ages, and then he's come up twice in one week. But like, it's like this real kind of low growl. It's like vocal.
It's like The Wire.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Yes. Like the sort of the intro, the TV show, The Wire, like that kind of that song. But
are
done
you not
with...
are you not thinking of The Sopranos? Because it's got a touch of that as well.
No.
Okay.
I think I am thinking of I'm definitely thinking of The Wire.
Okay.
But, you know, it's that with, like, fucking blast beats and and screaming.
And it's not alienating if you're a metalhead either. It's not so odd that you will be put off by it or all of those sorts of things. Like, this is one of those albums where, like... I insist. I insist you check this out.
This is just to hear it.
Not even just to hear it. I think that there is no doubt in my mind that when we do our top 20 at the end of the year, that this will be in mine, and it will take like it's right up there already.
Yeah,
like, I feel as enthusiastic about this record as I did Code Orange and fucking the Menzingers. Like, this is going to be a standout album in 2017, and from out of nowhere, I guarantee you have not heard a record like this. It's not possible. You won't hear it and go, oh yeah, it sounds just like it doesn't. Like, we've thrown in all of that stuff into a melting pot for you so far to kind of describe what it sounds like, but all of those things combined and thrown into one sounds like nothing else. It is a hell of a record. And it's only 25 minutes long as well. So, bonus. It is by Zeal and Ardor. Let me spell that out for you, because I know that it's you'll be like, what's that band? Or week on Twitter. It is Z-E-A-L and Ardor. A-R-D-O-R. Again, this is one bloke who has recorded all of this. It is mighty impressive. Go and check it out now. All right, last album before we get on with Album Club. Comes from Power Trip. It's called Nightmare Logic. Power Trip are a band that we have briefly spoken about in the past, mainly because we've just been waiting for a new record to drop so that we can talk about them properly. This album is for metalheads. Flat out. Straight up. No compromises. No holds barred. Metalheads. It has got, I mean, the fact that it opens with a riff straight out of Vulgar Display of Power, with Kerry King style squeals, you know that signature sound of lead guitars, like, that had my attention.
Yes.
The second that it starts in that, I mean, I like Power Trip anyway, but there has been a black breath shaped hole in my life for quite a while, for a band that are able to switch from power violence to groove to stomp and do so with a guitar tone of the fucking gods. I think that this Power Trip album overtakes the Nails album as the best album of this type that we have reviewed on this show.
I agree.
Ah, tops!
Yeah.
Tops.
I fucking love it.
You're going to talk about Entombed again at some point in this one, surely.
I don't know if I am, actually. No. I was going to. What I love about it is it'd be very easy to pin Power Trip as just another thrash band. Like, hey, they sound like thrash or whatever.
Mm.
No, not for me.
I think they've got as much in common with Power Violence and like bands like Mammoth
Grinder.
I think
as much as you can hear shit like Early Testament or whatever, and like the like you said, Slayer as well.
Slayer and Pantera are all over this record.
I think Scott Burns era death metal-y production from like Arise era Sepultura, that kind of stuff. 90s metal, like a bit of New York metal, and even sort of proper two-step stompy hardcore's in there as well. Like, it's a But it sounds...
There is a two-step part in the middle of Firing Squad that is next level.
I know, and it sounds so, like, it sounds so evocative of those times, and it sounds like I had a chat with Riley from Power Trip recently. Yeah. He said, I think people just like us because we sound old as shit. And he was like, metal bands now, they all sound a bit polished or they're a bit weird. And he's like, there's no one just sounding like a metal band. And he's like, so we kind of wanted to do that.
I love that. Mm. I love that because they've got such a brilliant blend of old school and new school. There is a song called If Not Us, Then Who that just opens with an Anthrax riff.
Yeah.
Like they're not even trying. Do you know what I mean? It just sounds flat out like an Anthrax riff. So I think old school metalheads will get the point of reference, mm-hmm. the points of reference that are all over this record. Like if he's saying that, they're not exactly trying to hide that there's a lot of old school worship on here. But new school people, new school metal fans will connect with this because it is fire. It's energy, it's vigor, it's untamed, it is wildly exciting in terms of like the when the second song breaks into the third song, when Executioner's Tax goes into Firing Squad, like it gives me the biggest rush every time I heard it. Like every time I hear it, the first time I heard it, I actually laughed because it's like literally like one song stops and the next one starts at breakneck speed.
And not like just any song either. Like Executioner's Tax is so fucking great. I mean the whole. Yeah, I know what you're going to say. They all are. Like, it's brilliant,
like,
this record.
Like, cards on the table. This and the Zeal Ardor record are both in my top five records of the year so far.
Yeah,
like, this is a mental week. We've not just been at the Disco Biscuits. Like, this is just a mad week. Like, it's just the amount of times that I listened to it and was just like, this is so metal.
Yeah.
Like no fucking no mo- like nothing even remotely polished. Like the day that I am made king of the universe, every band that plays metal is going to be made to play with this guitar tone.
Yeah,
it is how heavy metal should sound. Like how heavy abrasive music that has any connection with metal, I would like to hear them sound like this. It's why it reminds me of the guitar tone that I always rave about that Goat Whore use. Like it's really like a fucking chainsaw going when it fucking rips. And this is it. It's pure metal. In the way that that's for the end of the year. But Code Orange's record like has flicks of alternative rock and it has bits of hard, like industrial, and I think it airs on the hardcore more than it airs on the metal, mm-hmm. although the flirtations with metal are greater on Forever than they have been at any other point on Code Orange, and that album's class is fucking unparalleled. What this is it's a straight up metal record. No fucking around. Like, you know, maybe there's a bit of crossover with hardcore kids because crust punk and like fucking thrash metal have been intertwined. There's those amount of those bands that we say that like kind of sound a little bit like Skeleton Witch.
Yeah.
That kind of straddles both of those things. But to me, to my ears, with my record collection and the way that I feel about the metal that I like most, stuff that's riffs are all-encompassing, powerful, will make you want to bang your head when you're listening to them on your headphones, straight-up face-ripping metal. Like, this is it. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, this is one of the best, like you say, straight-up metal albums that I have heard in fucking forever. It's so great.
When we talk about heavy records, we talk so much about the other influences and all the rest of it. It's rare that we just go, this is straight up red-blooded heavy fucking metal.
Yeah, like any of those grumpy people that are on YouTube going about, so the new Sepultura album is good, you're morons, you're posers, listen to this.
Absolutely. I'd like to invite all of those people back to go, this is the reason why we like people think that we're sneery about music on this show. You know, we can be at times, but only when it's warranted. Mm. And to me, it's because this is the standard we want. The standard of which anyone who is making an album with the word metal next to it, this Power Trip record is what they should be aspiring to. Like, it fills my heart with joy that a band can still do something. It's not reinventing the wheel. Like when we speak about Code Orange, we spoke about the fact that they were breaking down creative boundaries, like the way that we just did about Zeal and Ardor and all the rest of it. That they are in league with those things just by doing this stuff to such a high standard.
Yeah.
I just, you know what I mean? It's easy. Like when you love Pantera and fucking Slayer and Sabbath and Metallica, and like it's easy to sit there and think every great metal riff that's ever been written has already been written. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, but my God, An album like this proves that there's life in the old gun.
There's the well has not run dry. Definitely not. This album is fucking brilliant.
Yes.
And mate, and chant along fucking choruses like a motherfucker as well. Swing of the axe.
That is the one. Yeah, Executioner's Tax is the one.
But and the same with the title track as well. That's got a big old chant along chorus on it. But mate,
that song, that title track, when it stomps, there's a middle bit of that title track that just fucking kicks like a fucking mule. In fact, the verse of that, like, this is something I don't say lightly. The verses of the title track are like a modern-day Disposable Heroes.
Yeah.
Like, that's the fucking level of chug that goes on it.
That's a good shout.
I can't, honestly, man, like, I'm lucky enough to be seeing this band in a couple of weeks' time, and I could not be more stoked about it.
They're supporting Napalm Death over here.
They are, yes. Yeah, they are. So that's fucking hell.
I'm going to go to that.
I'm seeing them headline a show in a couple of weeks' time on t'other side of the world. But we will be bringing you more from Power Trip. Again, if you are a straight-up metalhead, we will not accept you not listening to this record. Honestly, man. The next time that you are sat bored and you need a record to listen to, fuck that, just now, as soon as this show finishes, listen to the Power Trip record and listen to the Zeal Ardor album. You owe it to yourself. You do. Right, album club, before we get out of here, this week's album club is one, like, we raved about this album when it came out on the old Metal Hammer podcast. They are the Damned Things. Ironiclast was the name of the album. The Damned Things were fronted by Keith Buckley.
He
of Every Time I Die fame, one of the greatest vocalists on God's green earth. No diggity. He's also got Scott Ian.
Rob Caggiano from Anthrax, now currently of Volbeat. And Joe Troman and the other guy from Fall Out Boy. I don't know their names.
Yeah. It's Andy Hurley.
Andy Hurley, yes.
They are the band. You will have noticed Fall Out Boy, Anthrax, Volbeat, but he was of Anthrax at the time, Rob Caggiano. And Every Time I Die sound absolutely nothing like each other. The Damned Things is also a name that is inspired by the 1977 Ram Jam song Black Betty, Wham-ba-lam. This album, this band, odd in terms of to look at them conceptually. Yo, half of Anthrax and half of Fall Out Boy are writing a record with the singer from Every Time I Die.
Yeah. Like, that was the initial, like, eh?
Well, yeah. I mean, it's impossible to not go, okay. Do you know what I mean? When that's out, and it got revealed by Rock Sound. Actually, the Damned Things just went straight onto the cover of Rock Sound. It's like, there's this project and here they are. It looked weird as shit. In the same way as, like, I guess, maybe not as weird, but kind of the way that we're looking at Dream Car at the moment. The Davey Havok and the dudes from No Doubt project that's coming out later this year. Odd. Did you, were you listening to rock music at this point?
Yes.
Did you have anticipations for this record? Who were you a fan of at this point in time?
Like Clutch,
right?
Mastodon, Gojira,
right? Okay.
Porcupine Tree, I liked a lot as well. Mm. Obviously, Dillinger, I always loved, and Convergent,
and
that sort of thing. And I heard about this, and I was like, "That's really weird." But Keith Buckley, and I love Every Time I Die, so
I think it's brilliant that we didn't even know each other at that point, and that was exactly my thought.
Yeah,
was. I mean, I love Fall Out Boy and I love Anthrax too. But like musically, I went, even if this is weird musically, Keith Buckley
will save the day.
Just in my eyes, can do no wrong.
Yeah.
And
they played on the second stage at Download in 2010 in front of about 9 people. And I was one of them.
Yep, I watched that.
So if you're one of the other 7 people that were there, because Slash was on the main stage that they clashed with, and it happened just before the torrential rain, which has not stopped at Download ever since.
No.
And I remember being like, just sort of intrigued.
Well, they hadn't even released anything at
this
point.
Nobody knew.
Working at Hammer, like, we didn't even have a promo of the record or anything like that. So I was watching it as blind as everyone else, just going there and watching this motley crew of people making How would you describe the sound of the Damn Things? Because it is fair to say that the Damn Things are a band that don't sound anything like any of the band's day jobs.
They're a rock band, aren't they?
Oh, absolutely. They're a hard rock and roll.
Yeah, they're a rock and roll band, but with the guitar tone at some points with a guy from Anthrax and the occasional roar of the guy that you recognise from Every Time I Die. But mostly, like, I knew Keith had that in his locker to a point, because I think if you listen to The New Black on Gutter Phenomenon.
Yeah, or Gutter Phenomenon in its entirety, there are
was probably the point where you'd go...
He'd let his melody go at the most at that point.
He can do that. But it was weird seeing them at Download that day, because he clung to the microphone on the mic stand, if you remember. Yeah. He didn't.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, well, this is a very different Keith Buckley to the guy that I'm used to.
Yeah, I mean, it's got to be a culture shock, because Every Time I Die are like a nuke going off live every single time. And this was, I mean, I've got loads of questions about Keith and some of the statements that he made while they were doing this record. But to me, musically, the Damn Things shared a lot in common with one band, and that band is Thin Lizzy. Like, in terms of the dual guitar runs and all the rest of it, there is so much, and chord progressions, there's so much Thin Lizzy on this record. But it's played through a filter of people that play on 10. Mm. Like, say what you want about Fall Out Boy and the rest of it, do you know what I mean? Used to be in Vegan Reich, so... the makeup of those people are in thrash or punk or whatever, like art forms that are pushed harder than classic rock. Do you know what I mean? Classic rock is flamboyant. Mm. That's what its characteristic is. When you think of Aerosmith and Thin Lizzy and all those kind of classic rock bands, that's what you think. You think flamboyance more than power and energy and aggression. And it's the musical stylings of Thin Lizzy, guitar-wise, played by people with that punch and that oomph in them.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. And I think as well, there's a little bit of kind of southern twang to it at the time, like Every Time I Die were going through their kind of a slightly southern flavoured thing. And there's a bit of that on stuff like, you know, Little Darling and Black Heart and stuff like that. And I was just like... It looked funny to see those people on stage together. And when the album came, you kind of went, well, on the basis of even seeing it, I don't really remember anything about the music, because I didn't know any of the songs and there was nobody there. And it's kind of just more interesting as a, like, well, there's Keith Buckley sort of doing his thing and he's spinning around like he normally does. And Scott Ian still did the Scott Ian stomp live. And it's quite hard to go.
Caggiano the same. I thought the Anthrax guys looked way more comfortable than everybody else.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And you just sort of bizarre go, well, it's like watching those people doing their day job just on the same stage. And with some different music. But when the album came, I was like, fuck. Straight away, like, massive. And Keith, for me, like, is the tinder. He is the gunpowder for this record. Because although I love, I think there's great riffs on it. And I think there's, like, you know, a great kind of, like you say, forward momentum.
Yeah.
His, like, lyrics, always. Yeah. Always lyrics.
Yeah.
And, like, vocal lines and just... He makes it cool. Someone like, let's say, Thin Lizzy, you know, all the runs are there, but it's likable to, like, sort of comparable to Thin Lizzy because Phil Lynott's fucking cool and Keith Buckley is fucking cool. On this record, he kind of sounds like cooler than he's, like, letting himself, because normally with Every Time I Die, he's cool, but he's a cool guy going crazy. Whereas on the Damn Things, I listen to it and I just go, I'd love to be that dude. I'd love to be that dude.
So, like, I'm not downplaying Keith's contribution, because every time Keith's on anything, he sounds fucking great. But to me, this is a real Guitar Hero album. Mm. Like, it is a proper Walls of Wailing, like, Guitar Hero stuff. You know what I mean when I say that. Like,
three guitarists.
Like, three guitarists. Like, you can imagine fucking standing on a, like, Slash style, standing on a hilltop, like, peeling out these lead guitar lines that are all over this record.
Yeah.
Because it is. Like, where they're a singer with a band, they're a band with a singer that don't play. like the guitars underneath everything. It is just like fucking when Noel Gallagher talks about Be Here Now, the Oasis album, he talks about the fact that they had loads of gack, and so the plan was to just fucking stick a guitar in there. Like, yeah. Do you know what I mean? I'm not saying that the damn things were on coke. I'm saying that it's the same principle. It just feels like excess, over the top, like fucking splendor when it comes to the guitar playing. Yeah. But the energy of those bands' day jobs is the only thing that I can see with the background. So where a lot of like quote unquote super groups fall down is that it all sounds interesting and it's always, oh, that person working with that person, and it's never quite the sum of its parts. The Damn Things album, this came out when I worked at Metal Hammer and we all loved it. Mm. We were a disparate group of people who like didn't see eye to eye on much the whole time I was there. Like, there were very few albums that everybody liked, but this was one of them.
Yeah.
What's so great about the songs on this record and what the standout moments on it?
Anthemic as fuck. Like, I think they've because they're one of the few times where a supergroup has managed to kind of straddle all the best things about their day jobs whilst not really doing their day job, if you know what I mean. Like, like you say, there are massive riffs on it, huge riffs, which I think actually, if you listen to Worship Music by Anthrax, which is where they sort of stopped being more of a metal band and started being more of a hard rock band a bit. I listen to that and go, he's kind of, these feel like stuff that was left over from like the Damn Thing session. And then you've got, like, again, Keith, massive choruses. And you've got, like...
It's funny to me, though, that the two Every Time I Die albums that came after this were the two, like, fastest, most frantic things that they'd done since what's the album called? Ebola-rama on it and everything.
That is weird. But I guess, you know, he scratched that itch, didn't he?
Now, I wanted to ask a question about something that Keith said after, because this album kind of went by the wayside, because it was quite critically lauded, but it never really took off with people. I think maybe that was because I'm not sure, like, old school Anthrax people are interested in them being in a band with the dudes from Fall Out Boy. It's because people are a bit blindsided by that. They won't just use their ears and go, let's try it out and see if we like it or not. It's just like, oh no, they're from Fall Out Boy. Yeah. And I don't think younger people got it because everyone was slightly older in the band. Why didn't this take off?
I don't know. I have no idea. I think it's one of the best rock records of the last decade. I think it's fucking... I listen to this still all the time.
Right.
I think it's fucking brilliant. I would take it over most sort of big... When you think of those kind of download main stage Sunday bands, those big rock bands, I would take it over the majority. Like, I'd have these over...
That's not a very high bar.
Well, Alter Bridge, I'd have them over Alter Bridge. I'd have them over anything Volbeat have ever done. I'd have this over anything Volbeat has ever done. I'd have it over anything Steel Panther have ever done. I think it's
I like it a lot. I think it's as good as Feel the Steel or the Glory Run of Volbeat.
I definitely do. I think it's wicked. I think what I liked about it is, like, when I saw them live, they covered Phaser by Quicksand.
Yeah.
And there's a little bit of that nod towards stuff on it as well. Like, if you listen to the title track, it's a proper, like, Tom's pounding screamer, like Keith does let himself go, and if you like Grave Robber and stuff, it's like a fucking headbanger.
Yeah.
And it felt like you know, it's a real, when you say hard rock, you know, Rival Sons being hard rock, and they're just not hard.
No,
like,
not at all.
I loved how hard it was, and I wonder if maybe because there's loads of melody and loads of choruses on it, but it's really hard, this record. Like, it's you know, the guitar tone on it is Scott Ian's guitar tone, and it's fucking, it chops. And like you say, there's guitars all over the place, and there's massive choruses, and there's, you know, the bit towards the end of We Got a Situation Here where Keith
that
really
whole
is
song
like,
is mad.
You know, where Keith really starts screaming at the end of it. Like, I wonder if that might have been a little bit alienating for people, or a little bit too much like because I don't really feel like it's one thing throughout the record. Like, it's not as one-paced as, or not even one-paced, but it's not as, it never sits still enough. You know, there's like fucking gospel backing vocals on it, and then there's like, you know, when I saw him doing that, and then they're covering Quicksand as well, you go, how do those two things fit together?
Yeah,
it's supposed in the same way as Fall Out Boy and Anthrax fit together. They kind of don't really, but they made it happen. And like, as a weird little album, I think it's fucking brilliant. As like a great album to put on from beginning to end, it keeps my attention the whole way through. And not many rock albums, like hard rock albums from that scene, do all the way through.
I can understand that from your point of view, because it's played faster and more energetic than a lot of those bands. I think a lot of those bands are flabbier, like they're built on a certain, like, I don't mean this as an insult when it comes to Water Bridge at all, like, because I think it's what they do and they're brilliant at it, but it's like quite pompous is the wrong word, but it's got plenty of pomp to it. Do you know what I mean? It's very gesturing.
Really, like Blackstone Cherry. Powerful.
Blackstone Cherry, those sorts of things. Whereas this is played by punks.
Yeah.
Like this, or this has got a punk rock spirit to it. It's a bit more breakneck in its approach. Keith said about this album that it's a band that he would rather be in when he's older. Can you see where he's coming from on that?
Yeah, because he gets to kind of stand still. He gets to like stand by the mic and he gets to sing, and I suppose he doesn't have to like roar all the way through. And you know, there'll come a day where he probably can't do that, so you know, he'll be able to sing, but will he be able to stage dive off a big stack into a group of like fucking tattooed vest wearing lunatics?
Maybe I also not. Think that if you're used to going at 180 miles an hour, going at 60 miles an hour, it's quite a drop off. Do you think we'll see the damn things again?
I'd love to. Like, I really wanted them to do more stuff.
Yeah, me too.
I kind of thought they might do when, you know, because at the time, Fall Out Boy were kind of winding down, or they weren't even together at that point. Whether they were just about to wind down.
2010, so yeah.
Every Time I Die, obviously, were doing stuff. They always are. But Anthrax, you know, we'd waited so long for an Anthrax album. I mean, this is pre-Worship Music. You know? We've now had two Anthrax albums in 5 years. It's not like they're shitting them out all the time. And it felt like they're a band who would go off and tour a bit and then not release an album and then come back. And it felt like them and the guys in Fall Out Boy had quite a lot of time on their hands. So it would have just been like, well, if Keith's not doing anything, then we can do it. Whereas now, it seems like it might be a little bit more difficult because Fall Out Boy are back and they're back playing stadiums and stuff. And that's a big, big thing. Anthrax have got a new record out and they seem to be touring the world. And, you know, we've just seen them doing a headline tour and releasing a poo album. And Every Time I Die, Every Time I Die.
I think that's the main reason why I'm all right with the damn thing staying away for as long as possible, because I don't want anything getting in the way of Every Time I Die.
Yeah,
I can only be honest with you. Like, I really like this record. I think it's great. I think that if you want a hard rock record with some fucking energy and some gusto and some oomph to it, then you could do there's not much that you can get that's in the same league as the damn things Ironiclast. I do agree. I think it's a really great record, but you know,
I feel like Every Time I Die could make this record if they wanted to as well.
Well, I think that the interesting thing is that the latest record, Low Teens, is the first time that they've gone into zones that are more hard rock terrains that this lot that this did, like It Remembers and all that sort of stuff. Is it Two Summers the song's called? There's one of them that's got like that kind of desert chorus that I was banging on about. Let me just make sure. I'm sure it's what is it, is it called Two Summers?
I think it is.
Yes, it is. I see Every Time I Die doing the best stuff off of this and loads more that's more exciting. So while I would never complain at a second Damn Things record, if it meant Every Time I Die putting anything back by a week, that's my gut instinct. But then it's because they're one of the best bands that have ever been.
It's true.
All right. So that is your album club this week. It comes from The Damn Things. It's called Ironiclast. Do go and check it out. Also, there's a lot to check out this week. I mean, Suicide Silence is essential hearing. Zeal and Ardor and Power Trip, both fucking incredible records. Make sure you go and check them out. We will be back next week to be joined by Merlin Alderslade and Tom Dare. Merlin Alderslade, of course, editor of the of Metal Hammer and former host of the Metal Hammer podcast, and Tom Dare, our very own extreme metal expert, to discuss all things metal in the Great Metal Summit. That is coming next Friday on iTunes and SoundCloud. Coming this Tuesday, of course, it is Eddie Hameda from Suicide Silence. Going to be an interesting chat after you've heard what we had to say about the album earlier on. And yeah, you can get it this Tuesday on That's Not Metal Extra, powered by Marshall. Hashtag live for music. Get yourself on Instagram, Twitter, and all the rest of it at Not Metal Pod. And get yourself on the Facebook page to ask questions for the Great Metal Summit. Our show is made better because our show is also your show. And you have some brilliant ideas out there. So share them with us on the That's Not Metal Facebook page. We will be back on Tuesday with that Eddie Hameda chat. It's going to be well good.
True facts.
True facts. See you next week.
Bye.
That's Not Metal is powered by Marshall. Join us for new episodes every single Friday featuring the most honest reviews, savage opinions, and everything you need from the world of rock and metal. Go on to iTunes or SoundCloud and search That's Not Metal and subscribe today. Premium podcasts are available at thatsnotmetal.net. Come on over there and get our very best work. Thatsnotmetal.net for premium podcasts. That's Not Metal, powered by Marshall, available on iTunes and SoundCloud.